There was a time, not so long ago, when the Chicago River's natural course flowed into Lake Michigan. But as the city grew, the river and the lake became more and more polluted, with raw sewage, industrial chemicals, and lots of animal waste from the old stockyards. Since Lake Michigan provided the city's drinking water, the pollution was a real problem. Typhoid, dysentery, and cholera were common. In 1854 alone, more than 1,400 people died of cholera. Enter Ellis Sylvester Chesbrough. He's the engineer who came up with the plan for the city to lay pipe for Chicago's sewer system. But that system still emptied into the river, which emptied into the lake, threatening the city's water supply. So next, Chesbrough designed a 2-mile-long tunnel 60 feet under Lake Michigan to draw the city's drinking water from further offshore. Workers dug around the clock for 3 years to build the tunnel. And after all that, it still wasn't good enough. Chicago grew, and so with time, all it took was a heavy rain for the dirty, stinky river water to reach the intake. But Chesbrough had one more big idea. It was his boldest yet. Why don't we reverse the river and send Chicago's filth down south? It was an audacious plan, and here's how it worked. Just west of Chicago is what we call a subcontinental divide. It's a high point geographically, but since the area is so flat, you barely notice it. Still, any water on the west of the divide flows westward, down toward the Mississippi. Anything to the east flows toward the Great Lakes. Chesbrough thought if we could only dig a ditch or canal through the divide and make it deeper than both the river and the lake, then gravity would do the hard work and carry all of Chicago's dirty, stinky water in the other direction and away from the Great Lakes. It was a brilliant plan, unless, of course, you live downstream. At first, they tried to do it by deepening an existing canal, the Illinois and Michigan Canal, that already followed that route, but that didn't do the trick. So they would have to dig a new ditch, a bigger ditch. And that's exactly what they called it, the Big Ditch. Unfortunately, other things got in the way. The Civil War and the Great Fire zapped city and state coffers. Finally, in 1892, 6 years after Chesbrough's death, Chicago got to work. Thousands of laborers started digging. They dug, and they dug. They used everything at their disposal, newfangled inventions like steam shovels, dynamite. In the end, they excavated 42 million cubic yards of rock and soil. That would fill up the Sears Tower 20 times. When opened, the canal would connect to the Des Plaines River, which would send Chicago's wastewater down the Mississippi to the Gulf. Which was a problem. Residents downstream in places like Missouri weren't too crazy about the big ditch. But Chicago had an answer. We believed that the purifying powers of Lake Michigan would make our stinky, filthy water cleaner. The solution to pollution is dilution, was Chicago's mantra. But Missouri wasn't really buying it. They got to work preparing a lawsuit. Smelling trouble, the canal builders raced to finish the project. On the morning of January 2nd, 1900, canal trustees undertook a secret mission. Accompanied by selected friends, wives, and a few reporters who caught wind of their plans, they set out in the early morning hours to strike the final blow to the last dam holding back the river. It was harder than they thought it would be. It took them a few tries. But finally, they broke open the dam, changing the course of the river and Chicago's history. It took a couple of weeks for Chicago's water to reach the Mississippi, but its effect on both the people in Chicago and the people downstream has lasted to this day, for better or worse. Chicago had solved its drinking water crisis and also accomplished what is still considered one of the greatest engineering feats in the history of the world.